Hey, everybody, we're about to go ahead and kick things off here. Yeah, yeah, come on, let's get an applause. We've had some great speakers today. So, first, thank you to all YAF virtual pass attendees for participating from around the world. If you're watching on Facebook or YouTube but not attending in person, head over to yaf.org/virtualpass to log in now and submit your questions for the speaker. Ask them to submit, if the speaker is using a PowerPoint, tell the virtual pass users they can download it through the PowerPoint in the resources section and follow along. And with that, I'd like to introduce Alex Marlow. So Alex Marlow is the editor-in-chief of Breitbart News Network. As Breitbart's first hire, Marlow helped launch the right's most infamous online publisher's family of websites. He's been involved in breaking and developing numerous news stories of international significance, including Acorn and Wienergate, which led to the resignation of former U.S. Congressman Anthony Weiner. Yes, laugh. Oh, it is funny. He was also in 2015 one of Forbes' 30 Under 30. Alex graduated from UC Berkeley, where he was a YAF activism advisor for the foundation. His work with the Berkeley College Republicans landed him on Time magazine cover. Alex hosts Breitbart News Daily, channel 125. Channel 125, where he sits, and he also sits on the National Journalism Center's Board of Governors, where he mentors the next generation of journalists and news media freedom fighters. Everyone, please welcome Alex Marlow.
Good afternoon, everyone. How are you today? So I asked, what would you like for me to talk about? Because as noted in the bio, I'm a veteran YAF activist. And now I'm editor-in-chief of Breitbart News, and I'm a talk show host on Sirius XM. How many of you, is there anyone from the East Coast out here? Yeah. Okay, good. Because a lot of the time, see, my show's on at 6 a.m. East Coast. So I'm guessing some of you maybe on the West Coast maybe catch it at the when you're about to go to sleep. So I kind of think of it as a late night show, even though it isn't an early morning show. But maybe some of you guys have heard me on radio from time to time. But I come from you guys. You guys are where I started, because I was a YAF activist at UC Berkeley. And it was folks like Ron Robinson and Pat Coyle, who's here today, were the folks who gave me my introduction to my former boss, Andrew Breitbart. So I want to talk a little bit, I guess the theme, and I want to speak mostly extemporaneously with you guys. I don't have a ton that I must say. So if you guys had a question, if you want to interrupt, that's fine. If you think you want to have clarity on something. But I think the best thing I can do is to give you guys some advice so that you don't have to have all the trials and failures that I've had to have, because I'm part of a generation that were new media pioneers, that were people who were part of a up-and-coming class of activists whose main activism wasn't holding picket signs or knocking on doors necessarily, but it was done largely online. And one of those pioneers, Andrew Breitbart, was my boss and mentor, and I met him on the roof of this very building, which is kind of amazing. And it was about 11, 12 years ago when that happened. And he gave a speech with themes that you guys will see as familiar, but were totally revolutionary at the time, which is that it's the culture that's upstream from politics and not the other way around. So we were living in a world where folks my age were just trying to be, I guess I was in my 20s at the time, early 20s, like 20-ish, 21. Everyone was thinking, I'm going to be the smartest guy around. I'm going to run for state office. I'm going to run for Congress. And I'm going to be the wonkiest wonk who's ever wonked before. And that was not, there's always going to be folks like that. And Andrew came in from Hollywood. I'm from Hollywood. I grew up in West LA, so just about an hour and a half down the road. I went to a prep school outside of Beverly Hills where there was lots of folks like Steven Spielberg's family went there, and Denzel Washington, and all the elite of the elite. Leslie Moonves, who's been in the news a little bit lately for some less than flattering activities, was one of the dads at the school. And it's one of these things where I witnessed Hollywood culture from the inside. And I saw, as Andrew saw, the making of Barack Obama the made-for-TV president, and it was clear that Obama was the reality show president even before Trump. Now, a lot of Trump's notoriety from The Apprentice, et cetera, but he was the second reality show president. The first one was Obama, who was anointed not by the Democratic establishment, but by the Hollywood elite. Jeffrey Katzenberg, David Geffen, these rich executives, you've maybe heard those names before. They're mostly the behind-the-scenes folks who control the record industry, music industry, entertainment industry, et cetera. Those are the guys who got together on their gigantic yachts, usually somewhere near the south of France, and decided that's the guy, not Hillary Clinton, who just did not connect with people. Did you see she brought back her fake Southern accent, by the way, last week? So good, so good. The more the merrier, please. In the era of authenticity, I cannot get enough of fake Southern Hillary Clinton, please, more. I don't think she's listening to my advice, so there's a chance if I ask for it, I should probably say no more Southern accent, Hillary. Then there's a chance she might bring it back some more. Andrew said that this is Hollywood's in charge. It's not the political class, not even Washington. And everyone looked at him like he was just jumping up and down like a monkey and throwing things at the wall that he shouldn't be. And it did not connect with folks at the time. It connected with me, though, because I grew up in West LA and I saw it. I saw that was the future. And Andrew, like so often, he was very prescient, and he turned out to be correct. Obama became the nominee, and then president, and then next up was Trump. And now all of you guys haven't lived in an era where you didn't know that the presidency was not a cultural thing more than a political thing. It's much more cultural. So the culture starts typically with folks about your guys' age. So when I'm doing my work at Breitbart, a lot of the time, I'm relying on the people. I am going to lack some perspective because I'm living in it day in and day out, which is why on a radio show we do some of the most call-ins. I think we have the highest call volume on all of Sirius XM, aside from Howard Stern, Joel Osteen, and then their psychic on Saturday. So if I can just beat the psychic, then that would be, I knew I've achieved something in my life. But we rely on you guys. You guys are the citizen journalists, and you guys are the trendsetters and the cultural setters. So you play such an important role, and it's so wonderful that you guys are here. So I want to go through, I guess I've got maybe 20 minutes or so, and I'll go through some of these lessons that I would tell a young Alex Marlow just starting off in YAF, as I once was 12 years or so ago on the roof of this building, starting my journey into a career on the right and hopefully fighting for conservative values. And then I want to have as much time for questions as possible. And I know we're doing some online questions too. That's good. The future, high tech, using video capabilities to stream all over the world. Amazing. Okay, so in terms of the lessons, the first one, unfortunately, is not a happy one. I tend to be a pretty optimistic person, but I'm not optimistic about one thing. I can guarantee you right now, we're in the middle of a civil war of ideas. Luckily, it's largely nonviolent, but it's our freedoms and our American values are under attack, and it's largely from the American left, the institutional left in particular. Now, what are American values? I think of American values, and I'm riffing off of Dennis Prager. A lot of you guys, I'm sure, have seen a PragerU video every once in a while. Is there anyone who hasn't? Okay, good. That's very heartening. So I was a huge Dennis Prager super fan when I was growing up. I still am. He's a great guy. And he says, e pluribus unum, which means one for many. So that basically means not having a segregated society, having a society where we do draw in lots of different cultures, but ultimately we have one quintessentially American culture. That's what e pluribus unum is. In God we trust. We are a Judeo-Christian country. That doesn't mean no Muslims allowed. It doesn't mean no atheists allowed. It does mean, though, that ultimately you got to choose a guiding light, a North Star. And for us, that's the Judeo-Christian value system. And that means you don't have to love every bit of it. I'm a practicing Catholic. I don't love every bit of Catholicism or the Judeo-Christian value system, but it's the best to choose from. And our founders had a lot of wisdom when they modeled the country around those precepts. So in God we trust, e pluribus unum, and liberty. I also mention, I add, all those are on your coin, by the way, as Prager always points out. I always add First Amendment and Second Amendment. I think those are the two crucial. The amendments to our Constitution are crucial. You guys should digest them all. But I think those two are extremely important because the First Amendment reemphasizes liberty, but particularly when it comes to speech. And this is where I'm most concerned about what's happening now and on our campuses. And that's why I'm starting here, because you guys are coming from you're in high school now. I assume how many of you for sure want to go to college? How many of you might want to go to college? How many of you for sure don't want to go to college, you want to go straight to work? Okay, so there's, and I've started, I've been editor-in-chief of Breitbart for about 6 years, and I'm hiring more and more people who didn't go to college, who want to go. I mean, you go in at a lower salary and you have less freedom, but you get your education from inside, so I'm not opposed to that, but I went to UC Berkeley. I was very into academics growing up, so I know a lot of you guys are still on that track. So you guys are in for a world of hurt if you're on the right and you're on an American college campus right now. Now, I went to Berkeley and I caused problems from within, largely thanks to YAF, which was really great. And I learned a lot along the way. So I wouldn't regret it. I'm not discouraging you guys from going to college. But if you look at what's happening right now, and these are just a few headlines I pulled earlier today. There's a public university in Indiana that now has a white literacy classes. 55% of college conservatives are now in the closet. So this is like, you remember being in the closet if you're gay? Now everyone feels pretty comfortable if you're gay, you can admit it. But if you're a conservative on campus, more than half do not feel comfortable admitting it. UC Berkeley, it's my alma mater. I used to get shouted down routinely when I would throw events. And what we do is we'd be very strategic about it. We would try to throw anti-terror events. Things that we think would be universal issues, where people would think, well, no one likes terrorists. So then we read quotes of terrorists saying we want to death to America and destroy Israel, and we're going to wipe Israel off the map. And we get protested. People would literally protest that, and they'd shout us down and call me a racist. It's very illuminating because it shows the left does not want to hear your ideas. They're not interested in debate or common ground. They're interested in shutting down speech. And if you see what's happening at Berkeley, where Marlow attempted to speak, and there was riots everywhere, barricades being thrown through bank windows. Ben Shapiro got to speak for the small cost of $600,000 in security fees, which is quite cost prohibitive. Ann Coulter, I don't even know if she made it to, I think her speech ended up getting canceled too. And so you can't be a conservative and speak for cheap. They put these incredible security costs, which stifles the ability to raise enough money, makes it impossible to give the speech. And then if you do get to speak, then you can't really be overly controversial. It's in the home of free speech. I used to study in the Free Speech Movement Cafe. And then I would attempt to go into Sproul Plaza and give a speech, and I would get shouted down by organizers from the communist bookstore, literally the communist bookstore. That was the students were a little too lazy. The bookstore folks, they were the real organizers. Okay, so violence on campus. 38% of conservatives say they don't feel safe on campus. And okay, Perry High School. Do you guys see about the story where the MAGA gear worn on USA Day ended up getting suspensions for wearing MAGA hats? You get suspended now. I could go on and on about the Covington Catholic school hate hoax that went on, where the entire media, including many folks on the right, immediately trying to condemn people simply for going to the March for Life and smiling when confronted by left-wing activists, well-known left-wing activists too. And then CNN continuing to spin lies about it 2 weeks later. That's why the president says the fake news is the enemy of the people. So this is what you guys are going into if you go to college, but I still think it's okay. Particularly, I encourage you to major in science, math, engineering, stuff that you can actually apply, because it's very strange when you get Phi Beta Kappa summa cum laude in political science, and then you get out of college and you're expecting the keys to a Lexus and a country club membership, and you end up getting rejected from jobs folding clothing. Which happens a lot now because the liberal arts degree is sort of getting watered down. So a high recommendation you major in something that you can actually use in the workforce. But if you get through it at all, you're going to need some tips along the way. But I don't think you are benefited at the moment by our social media overlords. And this is a big deal because how many of you guys feel like you've experienced censorship online because of your conservative values? So that's a good chunk of you have felt it directly. And I'll tell you right now, with my work at Breitbart, Facebook, we were the number one publisher on Facebook for the 2016 election, the most popular. A close second was the New York Times. This is not according to our own research, this is MIT and Harvard research that determined that Breitbart was the most shared, the most influential, the most impressions, and it's very persuasive, clearly, because we were able to, we're largely supportive of the president almost across the board, and our values ended up winning out, and the New York Times, CNN, ABC, NBC, et cetera, their values didn't really work out that well, at least electorally speaking. So what did Facebook do? Facebook changed their algorithm. And what does that mean? That means CNN goes up, we go down, the president goes down, and it's all by design. Mark Zuckerberg is sitting there, and he's got a dial, and he can twist whenever he wants, content up, content down, and it's completely opaque. There's zero transparency. How about what's happening over at Twitter, where you're getting banned for learn to code is the latest one. You can't joke and make fun of protected classes of people without getting banned if you're on the right. But if you're on the left, you can say horribly racist things about white men, for example, and you get promoted to the editorial board of the New York Times. So you actually get rewarded for it in our fake news media and our social media, and it's only getting worse. Facebook is, the key with Facebook in particular, and I'm sure, how many of you guys regularly use Facebook? Yeah, I feel like most of you guys don't, so which is great, but a lot of your parents do and your grandparents do, and if you do use it, they're collecting every bit of your data. And you are the product. That's the key, is that Facebook isn't a product. You are the product. They're harvesting your data. They're not telling you about it. They're spying on you. Do you see how creepy that report was, that the Flow app that apparently some women use to track their cycles, their menstrual cycles? Mark Zuckerberg has all that data. So that's all going straight to Facebook in Silicon Valley, and they're harvesting it, and they're selling it. I know that's over the top, but that is real, and that's happening right now. Google, you guys know, owns YouTube, the number one most censorious platform that I could ever think of, where they downgrade and put behind restricted lists PragerU videos like Alan Dershowitz, who is a liberal. I think they put one that was about baseball, like a history of baseball, behind a restricted list. These are all things that should show you a sign that the Silicon Valley crowd that's controlling so much of the social media, they're not into having a fair platform. So what's your guys' role in all this? Oh, first of all, you have to indulge me 1 second to talk about Wikipedia. How many of you think Wikipedia is reliable? Thank God, I love that. Okay, so we got three hands going up. Wikipedia is a single party state. Wikipedia is run by the exact same leftists who are running your colleges and who are running Silicon Valley. If you go to my Wikipedia, it will immediately start spitting out conspiracies in the first or second paragraph. Same with Breitbart. And so we have never had corrections anywhere close to the level as CNN had last year, where they had to fire three people for putting out knowing fake news. We've never had anything like that at Breitbart. Yet in the first paragraph in Wikipedia, it says we push conspiracy theories. And it says that I admitted to publishing fake news, which of course, if I really did publish fake news, why would I ever admit it to someone? Why would I? The most absurd premise ever. I understand there are some liars out there. I'm not one. But if I was one, why would I admit, hey, I'm a liar, check it out? No one would ever do that. So Wikipedia has that in the opening paragraph, and it's locked. There's nothing we can do to edit it. So Wikipedia, if you would like to figure out what is the basics of a plot from some Marvel movie, it'll probably be okay. But if you want actual substantive information on a political topic, you have to go elsewhere. And so this is, you guys are up against a lot, but you guys are on the side, I think, so long as we keep fighting. I think you guys are on the side that is the more popular side. So lesson number one, unfortunately, is that free speech is under attack right now. But how you fight back is where I start with lesson number two, which is be a citizen journalist. And being a citizen journalist involves all of you have one of these things, I assume, which is not an iPhone 8 Plus, the large size specifically, but a phone with a camera on it. So you guys should be recording everything in your life that you feel like could potentially turn into a news story. I'm constantly looking for folks like you guys to feed my campus reporting. And we have one person whose entire job at Breitbart is to field tips from the campuses. People who are sending us stuff. My email is alex@breitbart.com. You guys can all email me. There's no bad email. I probably won't respond, but I will definitely read it. And I will, if you have a good tip, I will forward it to my campus organizer who's reporting on this stuff, who's getting the word out about a lot of these scandals that are taking place on campus. Berkeley, I even forgot to mention the Turning Point kid who got punched in the face. I mean, it's getting wild what's happening right now on the campuses. And you guys, with your smartphone, you can at least get the word out. And so long as the word's getting out, we've got a chance. And by the way, the president, to his credit, announcing that he's going to have an executive order, details coming next week. And the executive order is going to be about that he's going to start trying to take away federal funds if your university discriminating against conservatives, which is great. I don't know if it'll stop them, but if we're loud enough, it'll be very effective because we'll expose them because their arguments stink. Okay, so the next one's kind of a two-parter, which is I recommend that you guys are fearless and you don't expect to be loved. This is one I learned very early with the aforementioned anecdote about trying to simply say that I declare that I don't like terrorism and getting shouted down by people who have no interest in listening. The left does not have any desire to meet you halfway. They have no desire to come to common ground. They want to squash you and they want to defeat you. So once you understand that, you have to understand that if you are an out and open conservative, there are people who are not going to want to be your friend in social media. There are people who are not going to want to invite you to whatever it is happens over the weekend that kids your age do, which I'm in my 30s now, so I have no clue what you kids do now. I assume it involves Snapchat, but I'm not positive. And they might not snap you a picture with the funny pig nose on it ever again. You might lose that opportunity, but good riddance, because those people are closed-minded and you don't want to surround yourself with people who are closed-minded. You want to be sponges of information. You want to seek out as many smart people, as many experts in your life, and pick their brain. Ask them a million questions. Always have talk radio in your ear, or a podcast, or an audiobook. That was one of the keys to my education. A lot of it took place in my headphones. I started obsessively listening to talk radio. Later now, a lot of stuff are on podcasts. I'm sure a lot of you guys are listening to podcasts. And audiobooks are unbelievable. You can get tons of information piped into your head while you're walking around your campus. It will probably be more valuable than what you're getting in the classroom, especially if you major in women's studies, women with a Y. You're definitely getting more on your way to class. Though I don't think there's going to be any women's studies folks at a YAF conference, are there? No, I don't think so either. All right, so, but when people come at you, you have to be fearless. You have to be able to stand up against the mob, not cave to the mob, and just embrace that you're not going to be loved. Embrace it. This is not giving an inch is the ultimate lesson that I learned from Andrew Breitbart, and I think the president's applied it very effectively. And this is, if you notice the pattern, even though some of you probably don't like some of his tweets, some of you probably absolutely love his tweets. For me, it kind of depends on what side of the bed I woke up on that day. Sometimes I love them, sometimes I'm feel like just do more and tweet less, but most of the time I love them. But the pattern is he's mostly fighting back. He's not normally initiating. He's normally waiting for someone to do something to him first, and then he punches back twice as hard. This is a classic tactic of the left, and that's how you guys should operate in your life. There's no reward for giving ground. I'm sure a lot of you guys follow Tucker Carlson, right? So Tucker got... he's getting attacked for jokes he said on a comedy show 12 years or so ago. And a lot of the comments in without context might be tough to defend. In the context of a comedy show, a little easier to defend. But the bottom line is he doesn't apologize. He doesn't go up and say, I'm going to apologize. He goes up and says, well, now I'm going to investigate everyone who's doing this witch hunt. That's the way to do it. Those are the lessons that you guys need to internalize that the establishment Republican types never got. They always got, how can we find common ground? How can we give an inch? If we give an inch, we'll get rewarded. The left will never reward you. You're not going to get rewarded for that stuff. A similar thing in your personal life, I always recommend developing grit. Don't be afraid to fail. don't be afraid to put yourself in situations where you're not going to be a star right away. And this is one thing that's going to be a big struggle for your guys' generation. It's been a struggle for mine, too, because millennial generation is similar in this way. But understanding that the world is, you guys know very little compared to what you'll know at my age, and then compared to what I'll know when I get to be Pat's age, if that ever happens. But who knows? I'm just seeing if everyone's sleeping. Building up determination, not being afraid to be called out, not taking any, if you go to work and someone says something negative, it's not personal necessarily. It's usually going to be about trying to help you get more information. And if you develop a thick skin, you're going to be learning three times as fast as your peers who want to retreat to their safe spaces and want to have their feelings indulged and to have get licked on the head like a mother cat. That's what your friends are going to want to do on the left. If you start building up some resilience, you're going to really accomplish a lot of things. Next lesson I would recommend for you guys, which is always have fun. I would recommend that one thing that's neat, and I got a chance to spend some time with the president on Monday in the Oval Office, and when I was interviewing him, he was having such a great time. Like, he really liked heckling his opponents. He liked plotting his strategy. He liked telling jokes. He likes talking to a room of people who actually are interested in what he has to say versus the folks at CNN and the press briefing who are just trying to get on camera and to get on television. It's a good model. Andrew Breitbart was the same way, a happy warrior. So those are the folks who are the most successful, are the ones who are genuinely have internalized what they believe, and they fight for it in a way that's fun. And so if you want to be, if you're on campus and you're having an event, try not to make it cold and sterile. Try to make it enjoyable. Make it a little trolly. I'm not saying that you go over the top so that it gets canceled. I don't tend to operate in a mean way. I don't tend to like mean, but that's sort of my personal brand. Some people do mean very well. The president's often very effective when he's mean. But I like making it fun. If you're losing the fun, then it's not going to work, because this is what the left understands, that they weaponize comedy. You know, they weaponize entertainment. They weaponize things that are enjoyable, that are addictive. And that's what the right has done very poorly, but we're just starting to get it with folks like Breitbart and with people like Trump. A few more, and I'm going to go quick so we can open it up to questions. The next one, and I've kind of been talking around this, which is next lesson for you guys, is study the left. And I think the left caught the right sleeping here in this country, and they're still doing it in many ways, because people don't understand that if you read on this history, and some folks are very good on it on the right, some are very terrible at it still, but Andrew Breitbart's got a book called Righteous Indignation, Excuse Me While I Save the World. It's a great read, and it's really fun and enjoyable, and he talks about stories of when he was at Tulane University, New Orleans, and partying, and driving around Los Angeles while he was delivering scripts and converting from a knee-jerk factory setting liberal into a conservative warrior. It's a great biographical story, but the most important chapter is when he goes into detail on the Frankfurt School and these folks from who make up the institutional left. And you'll recognize some of the names. One of the main ones is Saul Alinsky, but the left has a playbook that they are working to shut you guys down. That's what's happening on social media. That's what's happening on at Wikipedia. That's what's happening on your campuses, is the left is abiding by a playbook, and the goal is always immediate political victory, and the goal is to vanquish their opponents. Their goal is not to be fair. All of you guys want to be fair and have integrity. You want to win on a free and open playing field. The left's goal, as stated by the Frankfurt School philosophers, was that whoever wins in the end can then rewrite history so that they write themselves as virtuous actors in history. So it's basically ultimate victory is all that matters, because you can control the narrative about what people say about you going forward so long as you win. And once you understand that, everything makes perfect sense, and you start wondering, why is the left always so hysterical? Why are they freaking out all the time? Because they know all they have to do is win and everything becomes okay. It's a silver bullet. They're not going to be held accountable for past actions when they're in charge, because they will rewrite the record. So this studying of the left, it serves two purposes. One, it'll help you anticipate what's next. But second of all, I'm sure a lot of you guys read Jordan Peterson's book. What's the subtitle for his book?
Does anyone?
antidote to chaos. When you start understanding that the left is going by a playbook, the world doesn't seem quite as horrifying as it did before, because you realize we just have to beat their tactics. They've got the playbook. They've given it to us. Andrew Breitbart's written about it. Others have written about it very effectively. And if you start realizing what they're trying to do, it becomes easier to beat, which is why I love to use mockery. I love to use ridicule. This is stuff that undermines them. That's why when you give them an inch, you know they're going to exploit it. And it all follows a pattern. But the right was very dumb because we spent all of our time trying to compromise and seem reasonable and seem safe and not spending enough time learning our opponent, which is the left. Likewise, an addendum to that is I would study the right as well. I won't belabor this because I'm moving into unifying mode. The nation needs healing sometimes, guys. You guys appreciate that. But we're getting close to election season, where everyone on the right needs to come together. But the institutional right has really misled, I think, a lot of natural conservatives for a long time. Particularly, the issue that's most important for us at Breitbart is immigration. And for me, it was always very real because I grew up in West LA, Los Angeles has been totally gutted by illegal immigration, and they keep electing Democrats who have no idea how to deal with it. It leads to unusable schools. It leads to massive homelessness. I could go on and on about the effects of it, not to mention it undermines national sovereignty and is mildly offensive or wildly offensive in that way as well. But the Republican establishment has spent decades trying to keep our borders open because they're funded by a bunch of billionaires who like cheap labor. And so you start wondering, why is our border so open? I mean, why so hard for the president to get his wall built? That's why, because some folks on the right have been misleading you. They have been misleading you in very powerful ways. And that's something where you, if you're open-minded and you are reading everything, you'd come in contact with some of that stuff. I read a story which shocked me yesterday, where a very prominent editor of a right-wing publication that I'm not going to mention because I'm not trying to be mean, but defending Google. Defending Facebook. Of course, this person is gotten checks from Google in the past, not disclosed in the article. So this is the problem with the Republican establishment and why Donald Trump won. It's not just that he fires off these awesome tweets, it's that his values, he was taking this class of people who had been misleading the rank and file natural conservative voter that they were going to, we'll take care of it on immigration, but nothing gets done. We'll take care of you on trade. We'll make sure trade is going to be free. It's going to be free. Well, then why do we have a record trade deficit? Why are we getting rolled by China? Why are we getting rolled by Mexico on trade? Because a lot of the precepts that look really good on paper don't have practical applications. And it is the Republican establishment that has preserved that for too long. Now everyone seems to be getting coached up, which is great. But you have to be also fundamentally skeptical of the right as well. And you guys should love that, because I'm giving you permission, not that I need to, but I'm giving you permission to be the rugged individualist in the spirit of Reagan. That's what America should be. America should be people who are thinking about who am I? And yes, we can agree to disagree. And if we have integrity and we have an open playing field, then what we can do, come together, we can actually have these discussions that the Democrats are always talking about and secretly don't really want to have. Not a lot of them like showing up on my radio show. And it's not even a debate show. I just want them to explain themselves. They don't want to do it. And the reason why they don't want to do it is because their ideas don't hold up to any scrutiny. And so if you start thinking as an individual, it just makes life much more interesting. And you'll find that you don't get misled. And the last thing that I want to mention is the last lesson that I learned is looking down the field. And this is where you guys can help me. And this is where I want to start with when we do the Q&A, but also hopefully after this, you can send me emails. Looking down the field is so important, and it was our key to success at Breitbart. The first thing we saw was that media was going online. There was no print. Print was going away. It was inevitable. People weren't going to get a physical newspaper. Super obvious now, but 12 years ago, there were still folks who were our competitors who were putting out a magazine, even putting out a daily paper. Those are all going away. It's too much infrastructure, too hard to do. And it continued with starting to use ridicule, use mockery, use humor to start pushing back on the left. Understanding that it's Hollywood and the culture that's in control, not the political establishment. And then it turned to issues like immigration, where Breitbart, everyone thought we were crazy because we were the only right-wing outlet that was really focused on immigration and what the widespread, both legal and illegal immigration, was doing to working class Americans, to minority voters, to new immigrants who had come in legally. Those are the people who were getting shafted by our current immigration policies. And we thought that was going to be very animating on the campaign trail. And everyone thought Trump was just this barbarian. Sure, he was a barbarian in many ways, and we loved that too. But it was also the ideas. He was focused on immigration. He was focused on trade. He was also focused on China, which might be the greatest global threat. Do you know they're building man-made military islands right now in the South China Sea? Do you guys know that their Belt and Road infrastructure initiative is basically designed to use their money to get other countries all around the world dependent on them for infrastructure, so they'll never be a threat? This is global hegemony on a massive scale. The only person who talked about this on the campaign trail, Donald Trump. A couple guys are getting it, though, now. Marco Rubio, not one of my favorites, has been excellent on China. So people are getting it. And Silicon Valley is the biggest fight that we have right now, because that goes back to where I started with American values. And if we are so dependent on Facebook and Google and Twitter giving us permission to speak, and corporations boycotting you if they don't like how you speak, if that's the America we're going to live in, we have a big problem here. I'm not saying we go off the playing field. I'm not saying you guys close your Twitter or close your Facebook or something like that if you're on it. I think we should fight back on those battlefields as well. But it's not sustainable if we don't take a firm stand and not give an inch for freedom. And I think YAF does a great job of getting that message out there. That's why I'm thrilled to be here. And on that note, I'll open it up for questions.
Okay, so the first question for the virtual pass comes from Abby from New Jersey. She wants to know, what is one piece of advice you would give to students from your time as a conservative activist at UC Berkeley?
Okay, so people from my time or people who are there now?
It says from your time.
Okay. I think from my time, meaning that I picked up while I was there. Yeah, so the thing I come back to the most is always how horribly the left treated us when we were there, which was so informative to me. And I always thought it was kind of, when I went to Berkeley, I went almost specifically because it was Berkeley, because it was a legendary harbor of leftist ideas and where the left thrived, basically unencumbered. It's like, if you want to see what Bernie Sanders' America would look like if Bernie was God, you just go to Berkeley and you spend a weekend there and you sort it out. And it's quite filthy. There's lots of homeless people, but there's terrific street art. So that's basically what you guys can count on in Bernie Sanders' America. But you learned that I learned very quickly there was no desire to have free and honest discussion. There was no desire to debate. There was no desire to have the best ideas win the day. It was all about shutting down of speech, that if you were to throw an event, they wanted to shout you down and mischaracterize you as racist, basically, which is the ultimate tactic the left uses, that if they start calling you racist, sexist, bigoted, xenophobic, Islamophobic, you name it. That's what Hillary said. If they can do that, they don't have to contend with your ideas, because who would waste time on a racist? Who would waste time on a bad person? So that was the biggest lesson of them all. I think it was a window into, you cannot be reasonable and win with the left. You have to be strong to win with the left, which is why the president wins. Go ahead.
Hi, my name is Jerry Jin from Desert Vista High School in Phoenix, Arizona.
Cool.
So on the part where you were talking about, like, one of the reasons why you support the wall is because illegal immigration, the inflow of illegal immigration, you said that it helped it would like deter, like it would be detrimental to like workers, right?
Yeah.
So I was wondering, like, in the grand scheme of like the just purely looking at it economically in the long run, like I don't know why that's necessarily a bad thing, because like the economic concept of creative destruction in the long run, like, should be able to help those workers, and like people, like, get more jobs and create better things in the new future and create new products. So I was wondering, like, what you're.
Okay, so I'm not sure I fully follow, but here in a nutshell, my immigration position is America first, meaning that I think we should do everything we can to help the American worker. And once the American worker are in a substantially better position, then we can start talking about bringing in more people, particularly people who have two qualities: one, skills; two, have a desire to assimilate and be a part of that American value system and really be a part of the American culture, and not come in as economic migrants for a couple of years, make some money, send it back, and then leave. That's not the intention of our country. We're a people with an economy. We are not an economy with a people. So I'm much more focused on the people. And if you import a bunch of cheap labor, particularly illegal cheap labor, you are artificially lowering the wages of our working class who would otherwise have those jobs. Now, anecdotally, I got a house last year, and I've had some work done on it, and I tend to ask the people, sometimes people see some of my memorabilia from my life as a conservative activist. You guys will look this up, you'll get a kick out of it. Newsweek once did a horrible hit piece on me, but they put on the cover, it was me with Donald Trump sitting on my shoulders. They photoshopped him on my shoulders. Now, I asked the president to recreate that pose in real life, and he said, no, I won't do it. Which I was somewhat relieved by in some ways. But so people see that, and they start talking to me. And a lot of these folks, because I live in the DC Beltway, they're working class, a lot of them minorities. And a lot of them don't dig the president, but the one place where they dig the president is immigration, because they don't want to have, there's a huge immigrant population there, and they don't want a bunch of particularly illegal immigration coming in, and if they're not going to take the jobs, they're certainly going to make it so that the American worker is not going to get paid as much. So that's my primary concern. Now, when you start seeing wage growth, which we're just starting to see that, then you can start talking about more immigration coming in, but not until there's evidence that the wages are going up. Once the wages are going up, then you can start talking about balancing the scales a bit to help the business class. But the business class has so much lobbying, so much money, so much power, so much influence. I'm not worried about them. I'm worried about the people in the Midwest who lost all their factories over this bogus promise of free trade. I'm much more focused on them. So does that help?
I just have like a follow-up question. So, like, sure. I understand that like you care about the people in the short run, but like the long run, do you think that like it'll be stalling the economy further by like trying to like prop up these workers instead of letting the factories just fall and let new like factories with new improved products like raise up?
Yeah, or, I don't think that's what is going to happen. I think what's going to happen is we're going to see the I love that on paper. It looks right on paper. That's sort of the Ayn Randian view on paper, but in reality, we've seen what happened in the Midwest. All the factories are gone. They're ghost towns now. People are addicted to fentanyl and opioids. It is such an underreported issue, and it's reported constantly. It's still not enough what's happened with the illegal drugs that have come over and the addiction that is just gutting. You guys should all read Hillbilly Elegy by J.D. Vance if you guys haven't read it. It will describe what I'm saying in such also, he speaks very clearly. He writes very clearly. But read that and then shoot me an email and tell me what you think.
Thank you so much.
Okay. Great question, by the way.
Hello, I'm Jack Barth, and I go to Holy Family Catholic High School in Minnesota.
Cool.
And so back in 2016, I was hearing about Breitbart, and the media was portraying it as an alt-right mouthpiece of quasi-racists, so I didn't come.
Quasi, that's good. That's good. They normally didn't offer the quasi. It's normally just flat-out racist.
So I was just getting into conservatism, so I wrongly stayed away from Breitbart.
Yeah.
And then later I got into it, and I found out it's not racist. It's actually a great editorial news, and they do great work.
Thank you.
How do you think in the future we avoid, as all conservatives, avoid falling for the media's trap of the racist, and not just to organizations, to individuals and everyone?
I know this answer is a little circular, but if you read Breitbart, we try to give you guys cues of what might actually be a problem and what really isn't as big of a problem. But it's a great question. And just to address that, it is, did you guys know, because I know there's a few of you in this room who thought the Breitbart guy, he's going to be a little nutty. And then you turn out to find out he's actually a little boring. So, which I think a lot of you guys were probably surprised by that. That's by design. And the company was founded on a trip between Andrew Breitbart, who is a Jew, and his business partner, Larry Solov, who is also a Jew, still the president and CEO, on a trip to Israel. And the first idea was they wanted to have a website that is an American website that was a robust defender of the one Jewish state on the planet. Because if you take leftism to its logical extreme, you start getting into some of that anti-Semitism. We're starting to see it a little bit in this country now, in the last couple of weeks, and you certainly are seeing it in Europe, where as conservatism fades away, and there's basically no conservatism aside from a couple of pockets in sort of central Europe now, there's basically no conservatism, you're seeing rising hate crimes. So in the right, in America, where there is this resurgence of America First nationalism, every hate crime's a hoax, every one of them. And then when you go to Europe, where there is no right anymore, all the hate crimes are real. So interesting pattern there. So they just smear us because we're effective. That's why they kick off PragerU. PragerU's not offensive to anyone. They kick it off because it changes minds. They're mad at Breitbart because we changed minds during the election, maybe millions of minds. And maybe we got a bunch of people who didn't like the Mitt Romney establishment and didn't like the Barack Obama establishment to come out and think, well, maybe this Trump guy, maybe he's talking about some stuff that could potentially be a nice alternative to some of these guys in Washington who have failed us for so long. And that's why people try to call us names. And so what I would recommend, be that rugged individualist. Think for yourself, tell your friends to think for themselves, and spread the word. Tell 10,000 people. I used to say 10, but now I say 10,000 people about Breitbart and whatever it is that is your favorite. I'm not just trying to be, I mention my company a lot because that's what I do with my time. But if you guys, I know there's hundreds of others who are doing good work. Recommend your favorite website or podcast or whatever. Just check it out. Listen for a week and then tell me, is this person racist? Are they really that offensive? They're going to say no. They're going to say that's totally reasonable. I can't tell you how many radio callers I got who said precisely what you're saying. I tuned in to see how crazy the Breitbart guy was, and then now I actually realize I agree with him all the time, and he's kind of nice. So I love that. That's my favorite thing. Anything else?
No, thank you.
Okay, great. What is the, I know we have some time, but what is the hard out time?
I'll let you know.
Okay, got it.
Hi, my name's Samantha Waldrop. I go to Shasta High School in Redding, California.
Cool.
And so you mentioned reliable degrees and getting reliable degrees in college or not going to college at all.
Yeah.
But if we're so stubbornly passionate about the political sphere and we just fall in love with it, and we do want to pursue that in college,
yeah.
Do you have any advice as far as not only being influential, but successful in surviving with that kind of degree?
Yes, and a lot of it comes straight from my list, so I'm going to refer to some of it. Being fearless, being fun. Also, there's one thing that I do think is important, which is having this is a quote from my old boss, Steve Bannon, that a quantity has a quality all its own. So be ubiquitous, be everywhere. Don't have one speaker, have 10. Don't have one debate, have 10. Don't have one rally, have 10. Just make it constant. Get yourself into a flow where I'm super big into energy management. If you feel like you're really straining to do something, you're not going to repeat it. And you need to repetition. So if you're on campus, definitely make sure that you've got a full schedule. Everyone in your club, you should try to recruit clubs that want to stay busy, not people who just want to jerk around. I mean, that's not the point. If you really are trying to spread the values. You got to get in the habit, make it an everyday thing, not all day, but spend an hour, 2 hours, whatever it is, 5 days a week, doing something, getting ready for some event. And that's a big deal. The other thing that's most important, filming everything, going online, you know, tweeting, sharing, Instagramming, whatever it is, being cool and bold and looking good and all that stuff, it all works. You guys know this much better than I do, but all that stuff is very helpful. The robust online presence, until we all get kicked off, which seems like it's inevitable at this point, but until we get completely shut out, be big online in your spare time as well. If it's making you unhappy, if you're getting triggered too much on Twitter, then go offline for a little bit. You can come back to it. But it's in a nutshell is where I would start.
Hi, I'm June White from Pinecrest High School in North Carolina. And during your speech, you said don't give an inch because there's no reward for doing so.
Yeah.
And I was just wondering how we apply that to government, specifically policies in Congress.
Yeah, that's different. Congress is a different job. I'm talking more about an activism, and I tried to preface it as my lessons for activists. It's a tougher job sometimes in the Congress. I don't think I would necessarily make a great congressperson. Maybe I'll run for Congress one day, and then someone will use that quote. Because it's a negotiating job, and it's very frustrating for people like I am, and like some of you are, and most of you will be, where you guys are going to live and breathe this stuff every day, and you're going to see very complex nuances to issues, and pitfalls, and traps, and you're going to watch your favorite politician fall into them over and over again, and then they're not going to be your favorite anymore, and then you're going to feel very jaded by the whole thing. That is how Congress is designed, so that it doesn't move very quickly. And that's why I kind of talked about seeing down the field. And I talked so much about the culture. The big change comes from within the culture, and change takes place over a long period of time. So you can be patient. You don't. Every bill doesn't have to be perfect, but there are some principles where I lay down the law. Like I'm a zero amnesty guy. So you're not going to see a lot of support on if we're talking about giving pathways to citizenship for illegal aliens. You're not going to see any support on that at Breitbart. You will at some conservative outlets. But that's one where we're pretty hardcore in that one. But then there's other things like on national security, foreign policy. We're largely a non-interventionist group. So my editors mostly don't want us going around the world. But I think a lot of us go around the world like meddling in other people's governments and having a bunch of foreign entanglements where we're committing a bunch of blood and capital. We're not really into that by and large. There's some folks on the neocon right who are into that. But that said, I kind of love that time where we bombed Syria for like 15 minutes and we freaked everyone out. I mean, just reminding folks that we've got the firepower and we are willing to use it, I like that. A lot of my staff hated that. So there are places you can give and take. So I would just say everything is not the end of the world. If some piece of legislation passes that you don't love, it's not the end of the world. If there is some piece of... If you feel like some opportunity is missed, it is if the culture changes and there's more folks like you guys out there in 20 years than there are like the Women's March crowd. If they double and we're cut in half in 20 years, that's when we got a problem. It's not one piece of legislation where the compromise didn't go perfectly. None of that matters. That's all a product of where the culture is, and that's why we have to keep spreading the word. At places like this, and why you guys got to go back and do your rallies and get involved, et cetera. Thank you.
Thank you.
All right, Alex, we're going to move into a rapid fire round. So students are going to keep their question really short, and if you can keep your answers short as well. Thanks so much.
Okay.
Hi, my name is Mason Strand from Canyon High School in New Braunfels, Texas.
Great.
I was wondering, you talked a lot about pushing back against the left in your speech, and how can we push back without really fueling the flames, if you will, because, you know, when we stoop down to the level of the left,
yeah,
then they just fight right back with more insults and calling you a bigot and racist, and that's not fun.
It kind of depends on the setting. What are you picturing, online or at school or?
Both, mostly. I've done both. Honestly,
yeah, yeah. Some of it, you've got to find your brand. For me, I'm not into the mean stuff. I really don't like being mean to people. I find it to be a great tactic. For some people, use it very effectively. I would not be good at that. But what I'm good at is that when I see a problem, at Breitbart, what we do better than anyone is we push narratives. Meaning when I identify something as a storyline, I will put up not one story on it, not two stories on it. There's not gonna be a definitive op-ed on it. We'll put up 50 stories on it. And we'll make it so that if you are going after our people or our values, we're going to make you famous. And we're going to do nothing unfair, but we're going to make it so that every day you're going to wake up and look at your Google alerts and it's going to be another Breitbart story on something dumb you said. So that's my tactic, and that's what I've perfected. And the president, he's better at being mean to people. So it's a, if you guys are good at that, I'm not taking that off the table. I'm not taking anything off the table aside from violence, because the left doesn't take anything off the table, including violence, as we saw in UC Berkeley. They're willing to do it. So you got to find the pushback that's most effective. But I recommend quality. I recommend quantity. And just trial and error. That's why I keep saying trial and error is good, because you'll try things that don't make you comfortable, and there are other things where you feel like you really have got it. I wish I had time to be more specific than that, but I think I should probably keep rolling through.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
I'm John Harding from Santa Cruz County, and I wanted to know when you think this ruthless restriction of free speech by the left began.
Yeah, this is why I say study the left, because they've always had a totalitarian streak. There's not one leftist regime in the world. Look at Nicolas Maduro in Venezuela. Look at the Castros in Cuba. Look at the Soviet Union. There is, look at what's happening in the UK, where they don't have a First Amendment. We want to expand into Europe. It's so difficult because they don't have freedom of speech. You're so liable for anything that's even perceived as a falsehood that's stated. Remember, as you guys well know, the left does feel entitled to their own facts. So this is doctrinaire on the left. This is why I point this out over and over again, and the left has control of the Democratic Party. It wasn't always the case. Bill Clinton was not a leftist when he was president. Joe Lieberman was not a leftist when he was on the ticket with Al Gore. These are just liberals. I think liberals are naive and wrong, but they're not trying to shut down your speech. The left does that. Everywhere on earth there has been leftism, there is totalitarianism. Once you guys get that, then it's scarier, but it also shows you what you're up against.
I'm Patrick Warren. I'm from Provo, Utah, and I am interested in basically spreading conservative ideas for a living and living and breathing this all the time. I have a conservative Instagram account.
Yeah.
I'm just wondering how, I guess if you have any advice, like how to get started, how to get involved.
Yeah. The best advice, I've got two big pieces of advice to start. The first piece of advice I would give would be to be a interesting person first and a conservative second. So you guys will listen to my radio show. Hopefully you can get an app, SiriusXM app. You can download it so that you guys can listen even if you're not up at 3 a.m. Pacific time. And you'll hear a lot of guests that I have on can bench press me on some of the facts because they're expert. I'm a generalist. I've got to keep an eye on the whole world. I get specialists on who have way more facts, but I can do a 3-hour show because I can call on those experts and hopefully be somewhat entertaining to people. And this is the thing that the right also gets wrong, is we want to be the wonkiest, and we want to rap about the founding fathers. Like, I don't want to rap about the Federalist Papers. Be a great rapper and then say I support the troops, or be a great rapper and then have a Tom Brady put a MAGA hat in your locker and just troll people with that. That is so much more powerful culturally than being just the next wonk. And some of you guys are going to be wonky, and I love you. I need you, because I need to read your stuff so that I get coached up. But a lot of you guys who want to be in the culture and want to try to make it in Hollywood, or want to try to make it in a place that is, or try to be an Instagram person, the best way to be popular on Instagram is to be funny and look good. It's not to be the smartest person on Instagram. So be smart, too, of course. But it's... be creative before you're being conservative. This is what the left nailed. They made it so that they dominated the culture, and then they start infecting you with the left of center ideals. We went the opposite. We tried to shore up all of our arguments, and we realized we had no battlefield. We had no canvas to paint them. And so we got to reverse that big time. So that's number one, what I would do I would focus on that. And I guess, second of all, I guess would just be, as I said, just keep trying things. Just keep trying. Don't be afraid to fail. And don't be afraid to reach out to smart people in your life and try to collaborate, team up with them, get information from them, get internships, start young. Try to say, can I follow you around for summer? I will pick up your lunch. I will pick up your dry cleaning. I picked up so much from Andrew Breitbart literally when I was in the going to get groceries and picking up his dry cleaning phase. That was where I, you know, the cleaning up after his kids who would come down to our basement office and scatter chips everywhere. Those were great years for me. I was picking up a ton of information, and if I came in with a big head and expected to have a byline on the website and a prominent featuring of my writing, I would have been out the door, and I probably would be bored as a lawyer somewhere instead of having a super fun job getting to talk to folks like you guys.
Thank you. And follow me at Political Patrick.
Okay, sounds good.
Okay, the last question from the virtual pass is from Zoe from Alabama. She asks, do you believe this narrative of fake news is accurate? If so, is it a new thing, or is it just something that President Trump brought to light?
Yeah, I think there's always been an effort to skew the news. I think usually the left's bias is in their selection process. It's normally that they ignore stories of illegal alien crime, but they will overplay police shooting unarmed black people. Like that will be because one of them fits their narrative that the police are brutal and blacks are oppressed, and one of them does not suit their narrative that illegal aliens aren't all going to be Rhodes Scholars, which is what they would like to portray. I think by and large that's a good example. But now we're moving into conspiracy mode, which is where the president says the fake news is the enemy of the people, where I know a lot of you probably think that's too much. I kind of don't hate it because so much of what we were told about what happened in Ferguson with the hands up, don't shoot, that was a CNN hoax. Covington, which was a hoax. Christine Blasey Ford's testimony against Brett Kavanaugh was a hoax. The Russian collusion narrative, we're 2 years into it. When can we say it's a hoax? Is it enough already? It's been 2 years. Prove there's collusion. They're talking about now the president getting indicted for they want to indict him for what? For using $100,000 to pay off a stripper who he had an affair with or something? We were talking about rigging an election with Vladimir Putin and the Russian government. How did we get to affairs with strippers from 12 years ago? These have nothing to do with one another, and yet it will be nonstop on MSNBC and CNN and elsewhere on the left. And some people, even like Glenn Greenwald, who's a leftist guy, he says too much. You guys got to stop. You guys got to cut it down. So there's just too many hoaxes out there to ignore at this point. So I think it's gotten much worse. I think there's this panic, this hysteria over Trump. And Breitbart's job has been very easy because of that, because we just point out, no, this is a lie, this is a lie, this is a lie. And everyone loves it. So we're going strong.